2 Corinthians chapter 3. It's also great to have some dear friends and some longtime friends now with us. They actually live in this area now, John and Sue Ravetic. Wave at everybody, John and Sue. I know you're just loving that. Like, yeah, thanks, pointing us out. For many years, they were elders at a church that one of them, once they moved up to Lansing, was one that I was a part of birthing and starting, and then was a part also of the network of churches I oversee. And then they went to Kenya to teach in the school there and be missionaries and everything else. And their daughter is at Wheaton, and they just moved back here, been here almost a year. And so it's always great to see them. They saw on Facebook, I inboxed them. I said, I'm going to be in Wheaton. Am I going to see you? They said, we just saw it. We're planning on coming to see you. I said, good. Always good to see them. Great folks. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. I'm going to start in verse number 7 of 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Paul speaking, but if the ministry of death written and engraved on stones, everybody, how many of you know what was written on stones? Come on, the Ten Commandments, correct? So Paul calls the Ten Commandments a ministry of death. If that was glorious so that the children of Israel could not look steadily at the face of Moses because of the glory of his countenance, which that glory was passing away, how will the ministry of the Spirit not be more glorious? For if the ministry of condemnation had glory. So Paul here, he calls the law a ministry of death and a ministry of condemnation. It is still beyond me why anybody that lives on this side of the cross would ever want anything to do with the law. I mean, we got all kinds of Christians all excited, hoping that now we got a new president that we're going to get the Ten Commandments back in school. I was thrilled when they finally took the Ten Commandments out of school. Because the truth is, all the law does with people is revive sin. It does not change you. It does not transform you. It actually is the opposite thing. I remember when we first moved into the building in Saginaw where we're at, our sanctuary kind of similar to this, and it doesn't go back very deep. But on the back wall, the music was just bouncing off the walls like crazy. And so we had to do something. So we put all these big foam, went to Guitar Center, and they ended up kind of looking cool too. You know, it kind of looks like art in there. And so we got them stuck on the wall. One of the ladies in the church said, we need to do something. We need to make an announcement because they come down low enough that 2 and 3-year-olds could grab a hold and rip some of that foam off. We need to make an announcement that we need to tell all of the children and the parents to make sure their kids don't pull that foam off. I said, we will never, ever make that announcement in this building. I said, because the moment you tell the children to not go rip on that foam's going to be gone in chunks. We've been there for 5 years now. None of it is missing. They've not paid any attention to it. They've not paid any attention to it because you didn't tell them to not do it. All right, the moment you tell people, that is the effect of the law, all right? It doesn't mean there's not good moral things that go along with that. The truth is, what we need in the schools is Jesus. We need teachers and students full of the Holy Spirit. We just don't need something hanging on a wall that they're not going to pay attention to. Anyway, I'm sorry. Lord, I apologize. Head down now to verse 12, and it says, but the minds were blinded, for until this day, the same veil remains unlifted in the reading of the Old Testament, because the veil is taken away in Christ. But even to this day, when Moses is read, a veil lies on their heart. Nevertheless, when anyone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Now, the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty, there is freedom. But we all, with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into that same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. Now, jump down to chapter 4, verse 6, and it'll tell us what's in the mirror. For it is the God who commanded light to shine out of darkness who has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Now, one thing I have learned, I have it going on 13 years now, I have been in some form of giving oversight to different churches around the country, a few internationally. And one thing that does is I'm put in a position of mediating quite often. I get put in a position where I am troubleshooting, if you may. When I'm on an airplane and someone asks me what I do for a living, I never tell anybody I'm a preacher because, you know, then they stop cussing and they get nervous. And they don't know how to talk to you, you know, or they're like, you know, forgive me for my French for the last 10 minutes. And I don't know what it is about the French. They must cuss like crazy. I mean, no one ever says, forgive me for my German, you know, for my Spanish. It's always them French folk. I don't know what that means. I still ain't figured that one out. But anytime someone says, what do you do for a living? I always say, well, I troubleshoot for nonprofit corporations. Because first of all, it keeps them calm, and then we can have an actual discussion. And a lot of times, 30 minutes into it, they're like, you're a preacher, aren't you? And you know, I don't lie about that, obviously. But one thing that it does is when you're put in a position of mediation, you're listening to two sides. And you realize that there's always two sides to every story, and to both sides, it is real. And somewhere in the middle, we realize that even though it would be like, let's say someone told Pastor Joe that I said something about him. Now, maybe I didn't say anything about him at all, and maybe someone was just trying to stir up some trouble, or he perceives that I said something about him. Now, even though I didn't, his reality is the perception he has. For all of us, perception is reality. We all view things through different glass darklies. We look through different glasses. We see through our background, our upbringing, how we were raised. And so all of us, our perceptions are different. And how we even see Jesus is all different. Much of it has to do with how he's been presented to us. It's whether he's been presented correctly or whether he's been misrepresented. If the doctrine has been correct, if the doctrine has been off a little bit. But however we view Jesus, according to what Paul is saying here, Paul is saying this, whenever you and I look in the mirror and we're seeing and we're beholding the glory of God, and then he tells us what's in the mirror, it's the face of Jesus Christ. Whatever I see when I look at Jesus then determines how I see myself and also then how I see other people. Whatever reflection I have of him will then reflect on me and ultimately will then manifest on how I treat others. Because what you see, you be. What you behold, you become. And what you perceive, you receive. Perception is reality. If you see it that way, then it is real to you, even if it's wrong. And so I've had to learn also in those positions to turn to someone and say, listen, you might not feel like you offended this person, but they feel that you've offended them. Just say, I'm sorry. All right. It's not going to hurt you. It's not going to harm you. But I didn't do anything. It doesn't matter. They perceive that you did. And there's a lot of times I've bitten my tongue and I've just said, please forgive me. Okay. I'm wrong in this situation. It's not. All right. If it will help you see me differently, then it's simple for me to just say, I'm sorry. Forgive me. It's not that big of a deal. But our perception of Jesus is extremely important. If I were to entitle this today, and I'm not normally a big title guy because people always ask me, you know, sound people always ask me a lot of times, you know, so what is the title of this sermon? And I pretty much say I can't name the baby till I have it. You know, I mean, sometimes I don't know. Sometimes, I mean, I have an idea where I'm going and we'll just see by the time we get there. Hopefully I can do it in the time allotted in Jesus' name. Help me, Father. And I remember reading a story back here a couple years ago about a couple that moved into a new house. I think this is a good illustration. They move into this house, and they get all settled, and they're sitting having coffee in the breakfast nook. And the wife looks out the window, and the next-door neighbor is putting white towels and white sheets and her husband's white shirts for work out on the line, and they're all dingy. And she's like, What is she doing? Is she not washed those yet? I mean, look at, she does not let her husband go to work with those dingy white shirts. Doesn't she know anything about bleach? Hasn't anybody taught her about bleach? Well, 2 weeks goes by and she sees it two more times and she's sitting there drinking her coffee, irritated. It's just frustrating her. She's like, I think I just need to go introduce myself to her just so I can teach her about bleach. I mean, she's just all frustrated looking out the window and seeing these dingy white towels and sheets and shirts. And then all of a sudden, one day they're sitting in there and she's drinking her coffee and she looks out and there's beautiful white sheets, beautiful white towels, beautiful white shirts. And she says to her husband, look it, she finally figured out how to use bleach. He said, that could be true, or yesterday I cleaned the windows. I don't know. You see, the sheets were always white. The shirts were always white, but her perception had to do with how and what she was looking through. So how we see things. It's so important how we view Jesus. Because Jesus never changes. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever, but our perception of him does change. You know, Paul starts out here and he makes very clearly to us, he says, anytime Moses is preached, a veil drops over people's hearts and minds. In other words, whenever the law gets preached to us, it clouds Jesus. It is still beyond me how anybody would ever believe that we still are to have any relationship at all in the new covenant with the law. When Paul is very clear in Romans 10 verse 4, Christ is the end of the law to him who believes. Jesus even said, I didn't come to abolish the law, I came to fulfill the law. But that was talking about in his life, because in his death, his burial, and his resurrection, he did abolish it, because according to Paul in Ephesians 2, the law has now been abolished. He actually took it, nailed it to a tree completely. According to Romans 7, when it's talking about a husband and a wife, it's talking about the law and your relationship now with the new covenant. He uses a word about the wife being set aside. It's literally the word abolished. Colossians deal with it. The law has been abolished once and for all. Hebrews 8:13 tells us the law was made obsolete at the cross and it will soon pass away. And it was finally finished and completed once and for all in 70 AD when the temple got knocked down and the people had no place anymore to even go and worship. That's a done deal. It's finished. Matter of fact, if that doesn't convince you, I don't know why I've never heard a sermon on Acts 15 when the Apostle Peter gets up at the Jerusalem Council and all of the apostles come together to meet and they're discussing about the Holy Spirit being poured out on the Gentiles and a bunch of believing Pharisees and Jews come along and they're like, no, wait a minute. We're not sure we even like the idea because we thought the Messiah was for us. We didn't think he was actually for everybody. And so... we need to decide what we're going to tell these Gentiles because just grace and just believing by faith, that's not good enough. They've got to be circumcised. They got to keep the law. They got to keep the feast. I mean, imagine if you're a good Greek, you're 30 years old. Paul shows up to Corinth and he says, he teaches you the forgiveness of sins. God has forgiven you in Christ. You've been reconciled to God. And now the good news is you get a whole fresh new start, a whole new creation. And they're like, whoo, man, this is good news. This is some good stuff right here. And then about 9 months later, some Jews show up from Jerusalem and say, that's true. But if you really want to be saved, you also got to be circumcised. All of a sudden, if you're a 30-year-old male, bad news. I mean, it went from good news to like really bad news, like immediately. You know, of course, all the ladies in the church were going, ha, we like this. We had to have babies. Now, you know, you guys are going to get yours. I mean, have you ever thought it through when the Apostle Paul said that certain Jews came from Jerusalem to spy out their circumcision? I mean, have you ever just thought about that for like 2 seconds? There's only one way you can spy out circumcision. Come on, I know it's Sunday morning. Help me out a little bit. I mean, can you imagine being in that board meeting? Well, Elder Joe, you got bathroom duty. How'd you like to be at that altar service? All right, boys, open up your robes. Listen, that's called religion on steroids. Anytime religion is trying to find areas of your life and peek in areas that ain't got no business, that is religion to the core. And then the Apostle Paul, you know, he gets up and he shares about his experiences. But then Peter says something extremely powerful. I know people have preached it. I personally had never heard it ever preached in my entire life. Peter gets up and he says this. He says, brethren, let us not test God. One translation says, let us not tempt God. Another one says, let us not grieve God by putting these Gentiles under a yoke of bondage that we and our forefathers could not bear up under. For we are saved by the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, just as they are. So Peter gets up in front of all the apostles and he says, anytime you try to put Gentiles or anyone under the law, you are grieving, testing, and tempting God. It's pretty intense, but it's happening right now all over this area at this time of the day. Wonderful, sincere preachers who are trying to reveal Jesus to people, but they're trying to reveal Jesus with veils in the way. They can't see him clearly. See, as long as there is mixture, as long as that is going on, we try to see Jesus, and I'm trying to see what he really looks like, but I can't really see him because every time Moses is preached, it brings confusion. You know what I found is that for a lot of people that have been serving God for 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years, a lot of them, their favorite verse is, "Restore to me the joy of my salvation." Because they're trying to get back to what they felt when they first accepted Christ. Because when they first received Christ, the weight of sin was off of their shoulders. The smile came on their face. Joy unspeakable. They're like, "Oh, this is awesome. This is great." And then they came to church the next Sunday. And we preached Moses to them. Now, I don't want you to misunderstand anything. There's nothing wrong with preaching Moses as long as you preach the Old Testament through the light of the finished work of Jesus. You've got to see it through him because the law and the prophets speak of him. I think a beautiful picture is on the Mount of Transfiguration. Mount of Transfiguration, Peter, James, and John wake up, and all of a sudden, Peter sees Moses, Elijah, and Jesus shining. They're being glorified in front of him. And Peter's first response when he sees the law, the prophets, and Jesus is, "Let's build three synagogues." In other words, let's worship the law, let's worship the prophets, and let's add Jesus to it. And the moment he does it, immediately, Moses and Elijah are gone. Jesus is standing all by himself. And the Father's voice from heaven says, "This is my son, hear him." And some translations say, "Hear him alone." In other words, don't hear them. Their only purpose was to point to him. You can see him in them, but they were not spoken to you. They were speaking about him. Anytime we spend all of our time without explaining things properly in the Old Testament through the lens of Jesus, it will always, always bring confusion. And we have people that, you know, their favorite verse is, "Restore to me the joy of my salvation." And then their favorite song, you know, they got to go way back. Some folks, "Take me back." Had to pull out some Andre Crouch right there. Some way back. "Take me back, dear Lord." Everybody under 30 has no idea what I'm talking about. Google Andre Crouch and "Take Me Back." It's a good song. But their whole focus is trying to get back to a joy they had rather than going on to perfection and realizing today is the day of salvation. God's got life for me today. It should be glory to glory to glory, from faith to faith. It should be more joy today. I should be walking in greater freedom. But you see, the confusion comes in when, and I know because for many years I did this. For a lot of years, because I was preaching the Bible, I thought I was producing faith in people. I've been doing something, those that follow me on Facebook, and we're putting it into an ebook right now. It's called Myths and Mistranslations. We're up to, I think, number 59. I'll stop probably at 60 or 70. But one of them is one of our New Testament verses that gets mistranslated all the time. Faith comes by hearing. And hearing by the word of God. And for many years, how I interpreted that is faith comes by hearing and hearing by everything in the Bible. But it's actually translated, faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of Christos. It's the word of Christ that produces faith in you. It's the gospel that produces faith. Paul in Colossians 3 says the law shuts up faith. I can preach something out of the Old Testament to you today that will not produce an ounce of trust, confidence, faith, and belief in you. Matter of fact, I could stand up here today and turn to the book of Leviticus and tell every one of you ladies in here, if you are here this morning and you are on your monthly cycle, we're supposed to take you out in the parking lot and stone you. How many know it's not going to produce a lot of confidence in you? It's not going to produce a whole lot of faith in you either. Matter of fact, I can tell you, if your kids acted crazy on the way to service and they wouldn't listen to anything you say, we're supposed to take them little stinkers out and stone them too. I mean, that is not going to produce, it's in the Bible, but it's not the gospel. It's not the words of Christ. What produces faith in us is the good news. It's the good news that transforms us. It doesn't mean reading that is not important. Paul tells us in Romans 15 as well in Corinthians that the purpose for the scriptures, the graphe in the Old Testament, they're there to give us hope. They're there to teach us lessons. It's there to be examples to us. But we have faith produced in us by the new covenant. So let me take you just for a minute on my journey. I'm a third generation preacher's kid on one side of the family and second generation on the other. And my journey has been defined, if you may. I've been through my life seeing the many faces of Jesus. Now, Jesus' face has never changed, but my perception of him has. And when I was a little child growing up in Sunday school, my perception of Jesus is that he was awesome. All I saw about Jesus is he had a big grin on his face every time he thought about me. He's looking at me and he's smiling from ear to ear because Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in his sight. Jesus loves me, this I know. I'm before the Bible tells me, so I remember in first grade, we had a children's crusade. I brought my whole first grade class because I thought Jesus was awesome. Who wouldn't want to meet Jesus? Of course, I also wanted the Daisy BB gun, whoever brought the most people. Anyway, I won that gun. Hallelujah. I wanted that BB gun. But you see, when I was a child, I just saw him smiling. When I looked in the mirror, all I saw was a Jesus that was full of joy. He was anointed with the oil of joy among all of his brethren. He's grinning at me from ear to ear. But then you get about 11, 12, 13, and all of a sudden you go to youth camp. And then you get into youth group. And then you go to some youth conventions. And all of a sudden, you know, because your hormones have kicked in, now Jesus is looking at you with one eyebrow up because you turned into a little pervert all of a sudden. And by the time you're about 18, you're downright a heathen and he's half scowling at you. And by the time you're in college, you might as well forget about it because you have messed up way too many times and he's just half looking at you, his face. I mean, now all of a sudden, he's not smiling as much as he was because now I'm seeing him through different lenses. He was smiling when I was young. Maybe there's a reason why Jesus said how we inherit the kingdom is as a little child. That we have to learn how to be childlike but not childish. That we set aside childish ways, but we learn that simple, as Pastor mentioned during the worship, that we learn how to simply receive as a little child. But however I view him is how I will ultimately view me. And then how I will treat other people. If my view of Jesus is off a little bit, or if it's veiled, you know, there's a passage of scripture. It's to be honest, man, it's been rolling over in me for at least 8 years. John chapter 1 says, "No man has seen God at any time until Jesus." That seems like a complete contradiction in the Bible, because 5 times in the Old Testament, people saw God. Abraham sat down at a table and had God sit with him. Abraham made God a meal. I mean, can you imagine feeding God? That's pretty intense. Moses, the Bible says, he talked with God face to face, that he had face to face conversations. And it's not that they didn't see God, it's just that they were still seeing him through a veil. There was a curtain in the way. They didn't see him clearly. There was misconceptions, misperceptions, but that's why John 1 says, no man had really seen God at any time until Jesus, for he is what God looks like. And so he's like, if you want to know what my Father looks like, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. If you want to know how to treat people, check out how I treat people. If you want to know how I respond to sin, watch what I do when it comes in response to sin. If you want to know what my Father looks like, don't look in the Old Testament. If you want to know what my Father looks like, look at me, because everything that doesn't look like me was man's misperception trying to comprehend who I really am, because they were still looking through veils. They could see them, but not clearly. And see, the more those veils are in the way, I walk through my life, and it seems like it took me more than 20 years to get back to seeing him smiling again. I had to finally get back to a place of just coming to the simplicity of being a child again. The Lord said something to me this past year, and it kind of shook me a minute, because it went against pretty much everything I'd heard most of my life. And he said, "You've heard your whole life that your main purpose on the earth is to serve me. Your whole purpose is to serve God." And he said, "You mainly get that because most people's mindset about God is still out of the book of Job and not the new covenant. It's still a judicial mindset. We still think that our idea of coming boldly to God is that we're still in the courtroom in the book of Job, and it's a judicial mindset, and God the Father is the judge who is sitting on a throne with a big gavel, and the devil is up there constantly accusing us, because the scripture says he was constantly accusing us. The problem is, we also know the scripture says that he was cast out. There's no accusations by him in heaven. He ain't there no more. He's a defeated foe. If God hears accusations, it's from those that are in heaven. If he hears accusations, it's because we've opened our mouth against each other and against ourselves. And we have this mindset that then Jesus is our attorney litigating on our behalf. And it's this courtroom setting. The difference in the New Testament is John tells us in 1 John that, man, listen, man, when you mess up, when you have lapses, which when you see the word sin, one of the meanings is trespasses, lapses, missteps, falling away. Isn't it good that 2 Corinthians 5 says that God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, not counting your lapses, your missteps, your falling aways against you? That's like really good news right there. I don't know about you. All my life, I never heard that God wasn't counting your lapses against you. Oh, no, he was counting them against you, and he's going to get you, and he's going to get you good, because your sin is what keeps you from God. Your sin is what keeps you from heaven. Listen, God doesn't run away from sin. Sin don't freak God out. Listen, sin is not, it's not kryptonite to God, that God hates sin because it weakens him. He hates sin because of what it does to us, not because of what it does to him. Where sin abounds, grace superabounds. God runs towards sin, not away from sin. As we've all heard, well, God cannot look on sin. You ever try to find it in the Bible? It's just amazing sometimes the stuff that we've been taught. There's only really one verse, Habakkuk 1:13, that says, God, you're so holy and righteous. How can you look on sin? How can you look on evil? And then we don't read the rest of the verse. And we're, see, God can't look on sin, comma, so why do you? Listen, if God can't look on sin, he's blind, and Jesus wasn't him. Because Jesus was a friend of sinners. Jesus touched sin, sin touched Jesus. Jesus was around sin on a regular basis, and it didn't weaken him. He didn't turn into Clark Kent all of a sudden. Listen, the only thing that may keep her from heaven is not sin. It's not believing in the sacrifice for your sin. Jesus already bore all of your sin. You don't believe that he reconciled you. That's the only thing that may have any effect. Let's see, when our perception of him is we're not seeing Jesus clearly. Paul said something almost scary. He said, if anyone comes to you and teaches another Jesus. That literally means that you could have sat in church a major portion of your life and been taught another Jesus. And not seen him clearly, either because of hurt or wounds or pain. Or you've just sat a major portion of your life and just had veils continually dropped over your eyes. And so you say you love Jesus, but I'm still not sure I like me. And I'm not really sure I even like my neighbor, let alone love my neighbor. Because how I see him will reflect on how I see myself and then how I treat others. You see, if our view of him is off, I'll give you a simple example. There was a man in the 1500s and 1600s, late 1400s, 1500s, a man that brought some wonderful things to the body of Christ, but he also had some messed up views. His name was John Calvin. And John Calvin, and I know I'm in a reformed area here. Hallelujah. Bunch of reformed schools around us. John Calvin had some wonderful things to teach and say, but John Calvin also believed that God predetermined some babies were born to burn and some were born for glory. That's why it was reported that John Calvin said, hell is riddled with infants. It's full of little babies, because if a little baby dies and they were predetermined already to burn as an adult, then they're just being tortured now. And so his view of God was angry and retributive. And so John Calvin, he has a man in his hometown in Switzerland that argues theology with him. Another pastor, by the way, who loved Jesus, who just said, you know what? I don't agree with your doctrine. And he began to argue with him. Well, John Calvin decides, rather than dialogue with you, he ties him to a pole and sets him on fire. You know, at least nowadays, they just unfriend you on Facebook and call you a heretic. I mean, dear God, man, thank God they ain't burning you at the stake. I'd have been burned a long time ago. Help me, Jesus. I mean, crazy stuff. I mean, he gives this man Jacob Cervantes, and he just says, hey, man, you know what? But you see, if your view of God is he's angry and full of retribution, and he's going to punish people, because even a lot of us folks that have gotten a revelation of grace only believe it partly, because we're like, well, all of God's anger and wrath was consumed at the cross. But then our eschatology is, yeah, but he's coming back someday, and he's going to slaughter billions of people. Anyway, hallelujah. That's not going to go down that road and behave. But you see, if that's your view, I mean, it's a double-mindedness. It's confusion. It's like, so is he holding on to some? And that's why I believe there's a lot of people, they want to really give their hearts fully to God, but they're like, I'm not sure. Is he smiling today or is he scowling? Does he have a sword in his hand or actually a sword in his mouth, according to the book of Revelation? Because he's not coming back with a sword in his hand. He's not coming back to slaughter people. He's coming with a sword in his mouth. It's called the good news. And he's coming back not to release blood and not to kill a bunch of people. There's already blood on his garments, because the message coming out of his mouth is, I already was punished, so you don't have to be. That's called good news. See, many times, rather than hear that, we're really not sure what kind of mood he's in today. Is he in a good mood? And listen, if you can't relate with this, thank God. Trust me, there's a lot of people, a lot of people that haven't been raised like that. Their walk with God is, he loves me, he loves me not. He loves me, he loves me not. I'm in the kingdom, just got kicked out. My name's in the book, just got erased. I hope there's some white out. I hope it'll get put back in someday. And it's this constant confusion, because rather than seeing Jesus for who he is, we've had all of these things get in the way. Veils that have dropped over our hearts and our minds, and then we wonder why, man, I'm struggling just to believe that he really loves me. And we'll even get prophetic words on Sunday that say, he loves you. And it's like, I know, I believe it, but man, I can't see it. I'm trying to see it clearly, but man, it's just muddled. Because you don't know what I did yesterday. You don't know what I did last week. You don't know how I acted a month ago. So I can't imagine that he's really happy with me. Because you see, for a lot of us, it goes back to, I know at least me for a lot of years, when I looked in the mirror, what I saw and perceived was, because whenever I think of God, I think of Father. And when I think of Father, my natural dad, his parents were divorced when he was 10. And my dad, from 10 till 19, had a horrible, when he was thrown around from family member to family member, he'd had abuse from stepmothers to stepfathers to aunts and uncles. It's just horrible. And at 19, he met Christ. For the first time, I've heard my dad say this for years, he said, I had someone who would never leave me. Never, there was stability. And my dad did an amazing job of raising me without having an example. But because I'm the firstborn and I'm the oldest, my dad, who was a very loving man, also still had his anger and rage issues towards his natural father. And so more when I was younger, my dad would love everybody at church and in town. Everybody would say, Pastor Jimmy's the sweetest man on the planet. And then he'd get behind the wheel, and he was so full of road rage, and he'd get in the house, and he'd scream and yell. And my dad and I have walked through this and forgiven each other and talked about it. And it came out more on me than it did my younger brother, because I was the firstborn. And so for many years, I realized that when I would look in the mirror, rather than see God smiling at me, I saw two different faces. One was, what's the matter with you? What are you doing? Or the other one, because I was a preacher's kid, it was the look. Because, boy, I would get the look. You know, Dad would be up preaching, and I'd be at the back row sitting with my friend Mark and talking, and all of a sudden, he'd pound the pulpit real loud, and I'd look up. I'd get the look. And every parent has the look. You know exactly what I'm talking about. Mom's got them looks too, trust me. I don't. You better watch it when mama gives you the look. But for a lot of years, I realized that when I looked in the mirror to see the Father, because when I think Father, it goes back to my natural dad. It's not that my dad never smiled at me. We have wonderful memories. But that's the one that got etched in my brain. And then the other thing I found, because I minister a lot in the inner cities of America, that when I share a story like this, a lot of people look in the mirror and they don't see anybody, because dad wasn't there at all. And so people have a Doobie Brothers mentality at times. You know, me and Jesus is cool. I like Jesus, but I don't know about his daddy. I mean, that angry, ticked off guy that not too long ago wanted to kill me. But then, you know, Jesus became the Father's Prozac, turned daddy's smile upside down, and now daddy's in a good mood because he whooped on our big brother. And he's all right, at least for a couple thousand years. And then we'll see, because he might get in a bad mood again. Am I helping anybody at all? Because see, if our perception is off, and it gets off because of many times wrong teaching, wrong understanding, issues in our lives, and veils that drop over our heart. Our job is to pull the veils away. I think an amazing picture is Jesus speaks to the apostles one day and he says, roll away the stone. They roll away the stone. That's our number one job is to roll away from people the law of sin and death that would keep them in the grave. We can't save them. Only Jesus can. Jesus then calls Lazarus out of the grave because Jesus saves him. And Lazarus comes out of the grave, but he's still full of grave clothes. And so what he tells the disciples and the apostles is, untie him. Take off the grave clothes, loose them, and let them go. The problem a lot of times is this, is people come out of the grave because they hear the good news. And a lot of times, rather than untie them, we wrap them up with more rules, regulations, and stuff to do. And then a lot of times by the next Sunday, we kick them back in the grave and roll the stone, the law, back over them. And we're constantly calling them out. I don't know about you, but I was raised in the Pentecostal church. And in the Pentecostal church, I got saved 100 times before I was 10 years old. All right, because we kept coming out of the grave and nobody untied us. Charismatic church wasn't a whole lot different in the 70s and 80s and 90s either. And those of you that are younger, if you can't relate with any of this, you just need to leave here saying, thank you, Jesus. My kids can't relate with any of this. Thank God. But I also, I get emails and inboxes from people all over the country saying, man, my view of God, I didn't even realize how messed up it was and how it affected my own identity. And then ultimately then affected how I treated my neighbor, my spouse, my children, and how I treat everyone. Let me stop with this. Back here in May, my wife and I, we've made up our mind. I mean, ministry in itself is just pretty, ministry is full of misunderstandings. It's full of folks lying about you, betraying you. It's just life takes place. So my wife and I, we've decided that at least once every couple of years, we're going to have a tune-up session with Nate. A lot of you have met Nate Blouse here before. Nate has come here. Nate is part of my board. He's one of my, we've been walking together over 20 years. And so I sit down with Nate in May, and because we had gone through some things ministry-wise, we're like, we just want to make sure that we're not releasing. I want to make sure that we're walking in forgiveness. We're not releasing any toxicity. Hurt people. Got to make sure your heart and everything is in, and your mind in the right place. And so he said, is there anything specific first? I said, yeah. I said, for 6 months, I've realized that I've never felt safe in church. In the corporate gathering. I said, truth is, I've been preaching now 25 years, and it hadn't dawned on me. But all of a sudden, one day, I was sitting in a service and realized, I've never really felt safe here. It's not been a safe place. And because I've had enough sessions before, I know how to self-diagnose. I'm like, okay, Lord, show me why I don't feel safe. Nothing was coming to me. I mean, just no clarity. And so I sit down with him, and he's got an anointing on him. I mean, sure enough, I sit down with him and, comes flooding out of me. He says, Holy Spirit, would you please show Jamie why he doesn't feel safe in church? All of a sudden, I'm 6 or 7 years old, and I'm in a little town called Alpena, Michigan, and I'm running through the hallways of Alpena First Assembly of God. It's a church my dad pastored when I was a little boy. And I'm running down the hallway. Now, back in the early 70s, if you ran in church, everybody in the church would spank you. I mean, like, everybody. Like, I hated going to church because, I mean, you know, I was a normal boy. And Sunday nights, you know, if you didn't have a 5 or 6 hour service and the Holy Ghost wasn't there, you know, I mean, it was marathon, 6 at night till 11. I mean, if we went to midnight, oh, God was really there. If you had a 6 hour marathon, and I'm sitting on wooden pews at 6 years old, a boy, okay? All right, I mean, all wound up and having to sit there quiet. And so I'd run, and sure enough, someone would pick me up. They'd swap me. Then I'd get a spanking when I got home because my parents had found out that I got a spanking at church by somebody. Then they gave me one because I got one. I remember here about 15 years ago, a little boy was running through my dad's church, and my dad picked him up, and my dad's ready to swat him. I grabbed my dad's arm. I said, no, you now go to jail for that. Do not. And he's like, oh yeah, you know. We're now in the new millennium. Lord have mercy. All of a sudden, walking out of a door was this woman I had literally not thought of for 42 years. Never had a thought of her. Her name was Cora, and my brother and I were made to call her Grandma Cora because when my parents went off to meetings and gone a few days, she was our babysitter. Cora was about a 380-pound German woman who was Cruella de Vil on steroids. Moles with big chunks of hair coming out. She was a horrifying woman. I mean, when she would stay a weekend with us, we would literally stay in our room and play with toys. We were afraid to go out of the room, all right? She was just an angry woman. But, you know, she'd make them behave. So I'm running down the hallway, and she walks out of the bathroom and sees me, scoops me up, throws me over her shoulder, and she commences to whip me. And I'm crying. Of course, I'm 6, 7 years old. And while I'm over her shoulder crying, my dad walks around the corner, and he stops, and he watches it because Cora had permission to do that. And so Nate walks me through forgiving Cora, forgiving my dad. And then he says, Holy Spirit, would you now show 6-year-old Jamie where Jesus was. All of a sudden, I have this clear vision. Jesus has got both arms around her arm, and he's trying to keep her from hitting me. And he's saying, Cora, this isn't love. This isn't correction. This is my child. Please stop, Cora. But in her anger, she wasn't listening, and it's not that she was a horrible person. She had her own issues. That's why she did what she did. But then I realized, not only had I not felt safe in church, I'd never fully felt safe in the Heavenly Father's presence because my father stood and watched it. He didn't mean anything by that. I'm not angry at my dad. That was an era. We thought that was discipline when it wasn't. And I realized that that was also a veil that kept me from seeing him clearly. There's a lot of us, we've been through things in our lives that we have a hard time seeing God smiling at us because of. Could be something in our family, could be something at school. But there are issues in our lives that Jesus is saying, listen, I want you to see me clearly. I want your identity to be so clear in who I am and what I really look like. And know that what I really look like is light, life, and love. I don't look like a lot of what was presented to you. I've had to learn through my life that the biggest struggle in life is not learning, it's unlearning. The biggest struggle is not putting on new clothes. It's having to get the old ones stripped off of you. It's having to learn to have all of that moved out of the way so I can see him. And would you come play so it'll shut me up? Thank you. Yeah. Just come, somebody play the keyboard, Mark. Just because you were playing earlier. I need to wind this down. I'm going to pray for you in just a moment, but I really want to encourage you to let you know that Jesus has never changed. He's always been smiling at you. You just didn't know it. Do you know that even in the old covenant, God was still smiling at you because he said he would cause his face to shine upon you? We just didn't see it clearly. We thought he was angry. We thought he was opening up the earth and killing people. We like Joshua, thought God was cool with killing little kids. I believe Joshua believed that, but it doesn't look like Jesus. My theology is getting simpler the older that I'm getting. If it doesn't look like Jesus, I question it. Jesus is perfect theology. As one of my favorite authors says, God looks like Jesus. God has always looked like Jesus. There's never been a time he didn't look like Jesus. We just didn't know it, but now we do. And he has to walk us through a journey of removing the wrong images and removing the veils so that we can see him smiling, a father who's full of joy, delighting in his children, a father who says, it's my good pleasure to give you the kingdom, father that says, I know the plans I have for you. It's to prosper you and not to... I remember back in the early 90s, I was preaching at a little church in Northern Michigan, and the sound went out, and I looked back, and the soundboard was smoking. I blew the board. And trust me, I've calmed down a lot in my old age. That was in my 20s. I thought if I wasn't climbing on the chairs and screaming at the top of my lungs, then God wasn't going to be able to speak or do anything. But I want to encourage you all. And this year, let God remove all the veils. All of the stuff that keeps us. I want to encourage you. And just study Jesus again. And not just everything that he says, because you got to take that in context, because a lot of stuff he said wasn't for you. It wasn't written to you. It's for us to learn, but Jesus was speaking to people under the law. So there's some stuff he said, he said things like, Matthew 7, many in that day will say, Lord, Lord, if we not prophesied in your name, heal the sick, raise the dead, and cast out devils, and I'll say, away from me, I never knew you. That one got me saved a whole bunch of times. Of course, Jesus was speaking there to false prophets in its context, not Christians. Because there were no Christians yet. Listen, Jesus will never tell one of his sons or daughters, I never knew you. So that verse has nothing to do with you. I mean, that one, I've had people come up to me in tears afraid of that verse. It'd be different if he would have said, you never knew me. Well, then that might have messed with us a little bit. Nobody said, I never knew you. Man, he knows us by name. He'll never say that. But watch how he treated people. Watch how he responded to people's issues and struggles and pains. That's what Abba looks like. And that's what we need to see clearly. Because if I see him clearly, I'll see me clearly. And then I'll begin to see you right. I only treat you the way I feel about myself. That's why the reason a lot of people are mean and ugly is because that's how they feel about themselves. Everyone loves their neighbor as they love themselves. If you don't like yourself, you won't like your neighbor. Ultimately, everybody will love their neighbor as they love themselves, because if they don't really love themselves, they won't really love their neighbor. A lot of times we don't love ourselves because we're looking in the wrong mirror. And we don't see him. Bow your heads, would you? Father, I thank you today. Thank you for your absolute amazing love for us. Holy Spirit, I ask that today you would remove all of the misconceptions, all of the veils over our lives, that we see you clearly, that we understand your heart, your intentions, your motives, that we not be afraid of you. We cannot be intimate with someone we're terrified of. It's an impossibility. I need to have awe, honor, and respect for you, the spirit of the fear of the Lord, but not fear, phobos. I cannot be terrified of you and be intimate with you at the same time, because perfect love removes all fear. But if love removes fear, then fear removes love. And if all I've heard is fear, I don't really know how to give and receive love. So I ask that you heal that this morning in our hearts and minds. In Jesus' name. I want you to do something. Everybody close your eyes if you would. And I want you to get in your mind's eye the picture you've had in the mirror of Jesus. It might be grinning at you from ear to ear. Thank God for that. But I also know there's many of you in here that's not been the picture that you've had. Maybe it's the look. Maybe it's anger. Maybe it's one eyebrow up. Maybe it's looking at you angry because that's how you feel about yourself. But I'm going to ask that that image begin to change, and I want you to begin to see Jesus smiling at you from ear to ear and realize that he's for you. He's not against you. His vision for you is nothing but good. Now, Holy Spirit, I ask that you do that in every heart and soul right now, that we see you clearly. We see you as you are, for it has not yet been revealed what you shall be, but when you are revealed to us, we shall be like you, for we shall see you as you really are. We encourage one another with this hope, that we truly can see. That's not something we're waiting on in the future. Reveal yourself now so that we see you. Remove every veil, every other issue, that all we do is see you smiling. In Jesus' name.